Welcome to Buzz TV, and today I am your guest host, Mark Russey, of the Mark Russey Experiment. Little plug on my own. Thanks,
go
Pat.
Go ahead, bro.
And I'm here with Mr. Pat Travers, legendary rock and roll guitar player, songwriter, singer for many, many years. Pat, what have you been doing with yourself?
The last couple of years have been very busy for me. Recording in 2012, I recorded three albums, one live one, one old blues one with the songs from the 20s, songs that were originally recorded in the 20s, and that album is called Blues on Fire. That came out real good. And then we also did a new studio album called Can Do. So, and then on top of that, I did some other sort of little things. So we figured it out. I did 52 songs in 2012. I recorded and mixed 50. That's one a week.
Very awesome.
That was a lot. And then, of course, we've been, you know, playing as well, touring, and been to Europe a couple of times. And but this year, you know, it just seems like there's a new energy going on. Social media has been very cool. You know, we kind of figured that out. And we're just, people are coming to see us, and the boys are playing their asses off, and then we got great new songs to play, and got the best reviews I ever got in my career on my last studio album. I mean, believe it, yeah. Even people that didn't know me or didn't, I remember there was one guy who said, geez, I hate to say this, but I really like this album. You know, he didn't want to like it, but he did. So, and I've been working on, I was in the studio 2 weeks ago working on another little album. I'm not sure when it's going to come out. It's kind of interesting. All the material is sort of early 70s style. Actually, I think that might be from Vegas. These guys sent me, a drummer and bass player just sent me the backing tracks. And I had to work with that. I had to put guitar, vocals, and so I couldn't change their arrangements.
Right.
Yeah, whatever they had, I had to go with it. I wrote a few of my own songs, too, to go with it. But it came out really good, so I'm excited about that. And it's just going to be a fun year, really.
So tell me about your band, the guys in your band that you're touring with these days.
Yeah, well, we've been together now as a unit for about 4 years. I mean, Kirk McKim, my co-guitar player and best friend and brother, we've been playing together now for about 9 years. Rodney O'Quinn, our bass player, hooked up with us at the beginning of 2008. And Sandy Gennaro, our drummer, actually played with me back in 81 through 83, and we recorded a couple albums and did a bunch of tours with Aerosmith and stuff like that. So Sandy came back in 2010, I think. And so the band's, you know, we've been... we're battle tested and blooded for sure.
Yeah,
this
nice.
This band has done
paid your dues,
we
right?
Paid our dues. So when you get to see is four guys that you know what they're doing and can pretty much play anywhere.
Yeah, you know that's right. Really? Can play anywhere. Yeah. Can do, right?
Can do, exactly. Yes.
So any advice you would have for up and coming artists?
Yes. Actually, nowadays is probably a much better time for new artists to get a chance because of social media. You can build up an audience that isn't just regional because, you know, you can get your YouTube video out there and get all your buddies, and the kids know how to do this stuff. I mean, I figured it out, so... And instead of having to win the record company lotto, which is the way it used to be, you know, you weren't, unless you got a major record deal, your chances of doing anything were pretty slim.
Right.
And getting that major record deal was akin to winning the lotto. I mean, lots of people that deserved a record deal never got one, and lots of people that didn't got them, and, you know. But now you can, you know, create your own music, your own videos, put it on YouTube, start to build up your audience, and it's worldwide now. You're not just like a, you know, a new band from Las Vegas. You know, you've got fans in Sweden and Japan, and then once you start to get, you know, 100,000 hits on your YouTube videos, then a record company's going to come sniffing around. Somebody is.
The build it and they will come kind of thing.
Exactly, because, you know, when you start to... have 100 or 1 million of anything. That's a big number.
Right.
And so I'm pretty pleased. And also, I think, you know, just I live in Florida, just outside Orlando, and my son's 18, and he actually is more into movies, but he plays guitar and keyboards and sings and writes and does everything. But he's got some buddies a little older than him that play, and they're awesome players. I mean, they're really guys are getting back to, you know, learning what it's all about, and a lot more substance and a lot less
and
style.
And wanting to play more than
and wanting to
program.
Play and finding yeah, exactly, yeah. Finding grooves, you know, and so that's exciting, and it's fun because these guys all think I'm great. So I you know, we'll go into the studio with them. And they're all 21, 22, and
just bawling about
but
themselves.
The music is almost the same, you know, and it just seems to fit really well. So.
How cool is that?
Yeah, I think
that
it's very cool.
Your kids are doing the same kind of stuff, and it's maybe all coming back around.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. These kids, they're into writing their own tunes. They're into, I mean, working hard on their instruments, and you know, really. Not just fluff. It isn't fluff.
Right,
it's great.
Right.
I'm very happy to see that.
And, yeah, not doing formalized so much anymore.
Well, what people don't realize is there has always been crap in the music business or show business. But you know, the stuff that gets played on the classic rock stations is the cream.
Right.
But at the time, believe me, there was just as much BS as there is now. And
yeah.
But now you've got, you know, there's show business and a music business, and they're two completely different things, you know. And the music business has gotten difficult because people don't buy CDs. They don't buy. Actually, my last two records were put on vinyl, so they're available as vinyl albums, which is amazing.
Do you think vinyl's going to come back? At all?
Well, some people like it. I mean, it's fun to hold that big record in your hand, you know, and it's fun to stick it on the thing. Now, what it sounds like, it's probably going to sound better than an MP3. Okay, because
yeah,
MP3 is my most hated thing. You know, I just can't stand that I'm in the recording studio at a sample rate of 96, you know, really high sample rate, and we're doing our best to make this thing sound awesome, and then it gets reduced to an MP3, which is like less than a hundredth of what it started out as.
So what would be the point then, right?
Well, Neil Young has got a new system that he's promoting called Pono, and it's all it is a higher sample rate. It's just to keep the higher sample rate instead of, you know, we recorded 96 or 48 and then reduce it down to 16-bit for CD,
and
even
again,
less
yeah,
for MP3.
And sometimes even less than that.
Exactly. You know? But Neil Young's got this new Pono device, and it plays everything back at high sample rate. So if you recorded the album at a high sample rate, which most people do anyway, it gets converted down after
right,
you're done.
Right.
Now that can be played back the way I finished it in the studio, the way I left it before it got turned
the way
into
you were
commercial.
Hearing it on the good
exactly.
speakers and
well,
in the good
yeah,
room and
but,
everything.
You know, good sounds good on just about anything. I mean, it really does. If you listen like to any Steely Dan album, you could listen to that on one little speaker or a bunch of great speakers. You can hear everything on there because it's very carefully balanced by people that know what they're doing. So the source has to be good. And then you get to the amplifier and the speakers, but if you've got great amplifiers and speakers and the source is like this big, then it, you know, you're never going to get a good sound.
Garbage in, garbage out, right?
Exactly. You're polishing a turd.
Right.
Right. So.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I'm Mark with Buzz TV, and this is Mr. Pat Travers,
Mark.
And this is my first time doing an interview.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pat.
Journalism is your new thing.
No, it's not.
Ciao.
Only right here inside the Railhead at the Boulder Blues Series. Always $5. Such a deal. All right, Las Vegas, without further ado, please welcome to the stage, ladies and gentlemen, it's the Pat Travers Band.
We'll be right back. Yeah. Hello, good evening and welcome.
Right here, Buzz TV. Fun day for me. I'm with Painless Wayne, and we're over at Painless Guitars. So, Wayne, tell me about Painless Guitars, what you guys do, and all the fun stuff, because I've seen pictures of this stuff, and I know how killer it is. But they, you know, need to be informed.
Well, for me, it's always been a passion. When I was a kid, I was, you know, I'm left-handed, and growing up in the late 60s, early 70s, it was really hard to find any left-handed guitars, and if you could, they were quite a pretty penny. So I kind of learned how to make my own guitars, first with a little help from a guy at a place called Vesely's Music, a guy named Ted Vesely, who had a store here right up the street here, actually, up on Charleston. And I had gone in there and asked him about making guitars, and first he explained to me how, you know, they had to use these templates and everything had to line up, and that to make a left-handed guitar, I'd have to come up with all new templates. And while he was talking, I picked up one of his templates that was on the table, and I flipped it over, and I looked at him, and he told me I was a smart-ass kid, and then he started teaching me. So, you know, I made my first couple of guitars and figured out basically, you know, what it was that I wanted, what I liked about it, and it just kind of went from there. And, you know, I've always been pretty creative. I'm an artist. It's what I do. But it wasn't until my oldest son hit the age of 13 and started playing guitar that I really, really got back into it. I made a couple of guitars for him, and some people were really impressed with what I did. And they told me about some other places here in town that I won't mention, but I think we all know it was one of the biggest guitar stores in town. And I ended up with their crew for a little while doing some stuff in their research and development. And then when that place eventually closed down and the owner passed away, I was kind of on my own. So since then, I've just been marketing my own product to pro musicians and friends alike, you know, people that I know that play. And it's just gotten bigger and bigger. We've gotten to the point where we've had to expand a couple of times. And now we're actually going to be looking for a storefront because we just can't keep up with the demand. At the last count, we're doing somewhere between 20 and 25 customs a month now.
Out of
this little space in the back of our tattoo shop. Like I said, we've got just enough room to keep up with it now, and it's getting to the point where we're really going to have to expand. So,
well, very cool. So, you know, you're doing custom stuff. You're doing repairs.
Yeah, we do all aspects of guitar building, repairs, customs, paint, upgrades, pretty much anything that you want. If you've got a favorite axe and it just needs to be set up, we can do that. Our prices are very competitive. We pretty much do everything by hand here. All of our parts, we use top-of-the-line parts. We get wholesale on all of our parts, which we pass on to our customers. You know, what I've never understood is why anybody would go to a corporate, big corporate chain store to buy something as personal as their musical equipment. You know, they buy an instrument, they pay top dollar retail for it, they get an off-the-rack item that was mass-produced, then they spend a whole bunch more money trying to turn that item into something that is custom and just exactly what they want, and they may get close, but it's never exactly perfect. My whole point was to be able to build customs for the customer, starting from scratch, build exactly what they want to their specifications from the beginning, and you know, give them full option from the choice of the wood to the type of electronics, you know, the pickups, the type of pots, the wiring harness, the schematics, everything that we use to make exactly what they want, and let them be involved in the entire process right down to the finishing and the setup. That way they literally get exactly what they want, and usually it'll end up running them a third of the price of what they would have paid for that off-the-rack, mass-produced corporate guitar.
Well, yeah, I definitely understand what you mean, because there's a company out there, and I won't mention them, but they have three letters, so you know what I'm talking about, and you see anything from them, and the price point is so outrageously insane. And one, mind you, you're still a new company in the world of instruments, but two, real people can't afford that.
Oh, absolutely. We could build $20,000 guitars all day, and we'd have a whole room full of them because nobody's going to buy them. Okay? It's a point of market. You need to build a good, proper product for your customer. But it also has to be within their budget and their price range, and that was very important to us too. You know, a lot of our clients are hard-working people who play guitar either as a hobby or they're part-time musicians, and they don't have the money or the the ability to, you know, buy a $6,000 or $7,000 or $8,000 guitar. They want something that performs and gives them the best for their money and is within their budget. And that's what we're willing to work with, pretty much any range. And we like to build really good platforms that you can always upgrade, you can always add to, you can always make better as you go. We're really specific about the quality of the platform itself to start with. The neck, the body, the type of woods, the assembly, the finishes, those things are all very important to us, and the quality of the actual platform that you're going to build. And then from there, sky's the limit as to the upgrades that you can do. You know, especially electronically, that's where we really excel. We can come up with some of the wildest, craziest wiring harnesses that you can imagine and make your guitar literally do anything, give you so many different ranges of tone from 3 to 4 pickups that the guitar is more versatile than any other instrument you'll have.
And I've also, you know, we were talking and I see one of the other things. Wayne can do the wildest stuff. You could have colors, you could have LEDs, lasers. If your brain thinks of it, this guy could do it. I've seen some of the stuff.
Plus, that's the icing on the cake, you know, is being able to, you know, first we have to build that platform, and it's got to be a good, playable sound instrument. But then from there, dressing it up is just the joy of it, making it your own, making it personal, making it so different, and making it a one of a kind. You know, the great thing is that some of the light-up guitars that we've made, because I've made some of them and used them personally, and I can tell you, playing on a stage and pulling down to a 12th fret note, you know, in a high squeal and flicking a light on and having your entire guitar light up will literally get the entire club on their feet. And it is, there's nothing like it. Also, it's that feeling of pride and ownership of having something that's just for you and that nobody else has ever seen. I mean, that's what custom's all about. Right?
Exactly. Now, I hear a little later on, there's a birthday party coming up.
Yes, actually, we're going to have a little party for my birthday. I'm going to be 29 plus 20 years. That's coming up on March 23rd, and that's going to be at the Dive Bar on Maryland Parkway. We are going to have a lot of our good friends there from The Offspring and Smash Mouth, all the surviving members of Sublime with their new band, Long Beach Rehab. Local band Vile Child is going to play. There's going to be a large showing of all of our guitar models that you can find on Painless Guitars on Facebook. And yes, every guitar that we do build has to be approved by one of the gorgeous models that we photographed them with before we will actually send them out. So that way you know they've actually been buffed the way they should be before they actually get sent to your hands.
And there are links to this right down here. So if you don't remember anything, just click a link right down there. We'll have it to the Facebook stuff.
The party is an open party. It's free, and there are going to be a ton of big-name rock stars as well as local rock stars there having the time of their lives. So if you want to come out and help me celebrate my birthday and take a look at the new line of guitars that we're turning out, that would be fantastic.
And you know, Vegas is just a hop, skip, and a jump from anywhere. We love to have you. Come on down. Come to the party. Deal with the strip if you want. But come on down and come to the party.
Yeah, most definitely. And if you're interested in guitars, I am the most personable builder you are going to find. You can inbox me on Facebook at Painless Guitars. I can answer all of your questions. I can give you quotes right there. We can go over exactly what it is that you want. And I will build to the letter your personal dream guitar.
So what we're going to do now is we're going to go run in the back. We're going to take a look at the shop. We're going to take a look at some of your custom stuff. You ready to go?
Yeah, we're going to head back to the little guitar vault where nobody goes. And I'm going to let the cameras back here where normally nobody's allowed in this workshop. I'll let you see where I make the magic happen. So this is my workshop, and it's a little bit cramped right now because, like I said, we're kind of using the space that we have left over in the back of the tattoo shop. But at the point that we're going, we're going to be getting ourselves a storefront within the next couple of months because we just cannot keep up with the amount of guitars that we're turning out of this shop. Come on back and take a look. Just watch your step. Don't touch anything. Up on this wall is a bunch of the new customs that we're in the process of building and finishing, as well as a couple of custom orders that are for customers. Down here is a one of the new Les Pauls that I'm working on right now in left hand. This one's actually for Geddy Reyes from Vile Child. This is a baby shower present for the soon-to-be new dad that I'm working on. This white Strat is for me. This is one of our new line of Strats right here. I'm just doing the final wiring on. You can see a few more of those style up here. It's got the red in the middle here. Oh, I like that. This J-Frog over here. Some of these are bodies that were left over from the Ed Roman days.
That almost looks like a old Kramer style
headstock. This is a J-Frog, original J-Frog neck.
Right.
And J-Frog body.
Okay.
This is an original Kramer
body and Kramer neck. And like I said, these are all from Ed Romans. We even have all the original headstock logos, everything from this company when Ed was turning them out.
Wow. That's amazing. I remember that company oh so well.
Yeah, this is a custom EVH that we're doing for my buddy Keith. This is a really, really nice piece. We did on Spalted Maple on an EVH Wolfgang body with a J-Frog style neck, and then ghosted in the EVH stripes. And this one actually has a big glass window on the back for the wiring where you can see all of the wiring that we did. We did 3 push-pull pots and pull-switched everything.
Oh, that's very hip.
2 invaders, bridge and neck, and then in mid we've got a hot rail.
Very nice.
Yeah. 5-way greenway switch, Floyd Rose, whammy. It's got all the bells and whistles. It's a really nice guitar. And this is for a good friend of ours, Keith, who had to sell all of his guitars a few years back when he got in a pretty bad accident. And this is one of the first guitars he's gotten to get since then, so we put a lot of love into it. It's kind of a special thing.
No, that's very sweet. I mean, as I said, we're going to bring some stuff in and have you do a little work on it just because I know you do good work, but it's so much easier when I could hold something and say,
sure.
See?
Refurbing.
This is just it.
Refurbing stuff is one of my favorite things to do. This bass belongs to Q-Ball from Sublime and from Long Beach Rehab. And this was an old Gibson bass that was actually given to him by the company. And it had gotten spray painted orange by his children, of all people. And then it had gotten dropped and the neck had gotten shattered. But the body is still in pretty good shape. And the pickups and the wiring and everything are sound. And it is original Gibson. So we're getting ready to strip all the paint off of it. We're going to put a new harp on here, a really nice chrome one. A beautiful maple neck with big block inlays. And make him something really cool and vintage. And then he's got a lot of memorabilia from his time in Sublime, including some handwritten notes from his fellow bandmates and some other things, some pictures. So we're going to cover the entire guitar with those in a graphic and then clear it in so that he's got all of that stuff, big Sublime sum and a couple other things.
See, now that's going to be amazing. Now let me ask you a question. Now I see there with 4 holes, that was a unit that was a bolt-on neck.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just say you had one piece.
Sure.
And you snapped your neck. Fortunately, I haven't had that issue. Is that something that's fixable, or is that something you're pretty much SOL on?
Here we have a Les Paul Custom where the entire headstock is missing.
Oh my, yes it is.
So what I'm looking for is one with a body that's in the shape where I can pull a donor neck off of it. This one may be a good replacement. We'll see.
Right.
But eventually I will cut and join the two pieces together and put it back together.
So stuff like that is definitely salvageable. So if you have
anything is salvageable if you have the skills. There are certain things that you just don't want to attempt unless you really have the guitar skills. You know, if you don't have the building skills, you're just wasting your time and wood. So.
Exactly. Yeah, we had an issue with I have a original Jackson Charvel 98 model.
Yeah.
And I beat the hell on this way. I mean, it was. A Floyd Rose, but it was still under pat. So I went to change a string one day and popped all my strings off, and my pole sat at an angle. I couldn't get this thing to sit right, and I brought it in, and I guess through the years those holes got a little bigger. Fortunately, it was able to get salvaged where they were able to fill it with putty. And it held, thank God.
What we do, especially in a position like that where you might have to reset a pole,
right,
is we will use like a wooden dowel, a heavy, good style of wood, you know, a mahogany or something, or even maple if need be. And we'll cut the dowel down till it fits into the spot almost like a cork. We'll tap it into place, glue it into place, and then it becomes solid, and we can literally re-drill that, even if it's only a quarter of an inch over, and put the post back in. Do you understand what I mean?
Exactly. Well, you know, I might be bringing you this Charvel somewhere down the road if this repair doesn't hold off. But I mean, myself, like we were talking.
And there's a few other options that you can do. You can always router out a small space, and you can fit a block in there that's made out of steel that the post's attached to. And, you know, it's almost like a plate. There's a few options that you can do for older guitars. Sometimes when the body wood is so shot, the only thing you can do is replace the wood.
Right.
So.
See, for me, it's out of all my guitars, that's my favorite accent. It's forever. Mm-hmm. I'll find a way to keep it going.
This Iceman that's right behind you with the Air Force logos and stuff on it was in 3 pieces when I got it. It was in the boneyard.
Wow. And,
I repaired the entire body, put it back together, did all the custom paint on it and everything else. So yeah, you know, it usually has to be pretty wrecked before we'll pass on it.
Very hip.
Well, Wayne, let me ask you a quick question. Is there something I might have left out, or some information we need to let everybody know about Painless Guitars?
If you're really looking for custom, then you want a builder that's going to be accessible. Somebody that is really going to get behind your ideas and build exactly what you want. Somebody that sees your vision and makes it happen. And somebody that understands the budget that you're working with and is willing to work within those constraints to give you the best instrument they can. Customer service, I think, is our highest point here. Our whole goal is to make our customers thrilled with what they get. And I can't imagine ever selling, you know, just one guitar to a person. Almost every customer I have has bought multiple items for me. They've also brought their personal guitars that they've had, you know, brand name guitars in for me to rework or refurb. You know, you build a relationship with those customers and you make them happy. I really do this more of a passion than anything else. That's what it's always been for me. And the quality of the instruments comes before anything else.
Now, something we've talked about, and I just think people should know, because it's something you're not plugging, but I think it's cool. You do a lot of stuff for local bands here. You build instruments, you give out instruments, you do stuff for the school district as well. So that's just a plug I want to personally give, because, you know, so many people are in this. And again, I understand we all have to get paid. But music, you go above and beyond, and that is such a cool thing, especially in this business.
People don't realize how important music is to everything, how important music is. Music is a universal language. Music is it's about math and science. People don't understand that. They don't realize that any student that plays music will usually have 20 to 30% better grades than a non-musician student. They don't realize that music can give you fulfillment, that it can give you drive and passion. They don't realize that it can change your life and the way that you see things. But those who have tried music, those who consider themselves musicians, they understand, they know the difference. And I'll promote music any way I can. And promoting the local scene is one of the best things that you can do for music. And doing anything for the music programs in our schools, you just can't go wrong there. They're highly underrated. They're very understaffed and underpromoted now. The music programs are disappearing from schools all over the United States, and I think it's a crime. I think that it should be more important than anything else, because it teaches you a discipline and it teaches you how to have a mathematical brain and how to think in a rhythm or a pattern. And it does all this while allowing you to express yourself in ways you couldn't possibly imagine. And I don't think there's anything else that you will find that they can teach you in school that will do that.
And, you know, the most important thing, it teaches you how to deal with people. Because you know what? Eventually, you're going to play with someone or a group of people. And right away, you're going to learn this is a team. One person does not control things.
Absolutely.
And that's a great skill to have, just like sports. I'm not saying sports are bad, but you have to have everything. And that's what a lot of people are lacking. So, you
true
know,
musicians from anywhere in the world that have never met, that don't speak the same language, can get together in a room and they can do something flawlessly because they all understand that one thing. It's the universal language, and that's what people don't realize. They don't understand how important it really is. To the soul, to the heart, to the mind, they just don't get it. And I think if they did, there would be more music programs. I think it wouldn't be the thing that you see being cut first in all of the schools.
Exactly. But I had to give you that shout out because it is such a very cool thing you do. Enough people don't get it or do it. So I wanted to thank you, personally thank you, because I don't think you hear that enough.
Like I said, it's my pleasure. I've got four kids of my own. They're all musicians. And my house literally looks like a music store. And it's the happiest place on earth. They literally get to express themselves on a daily basis in a way that means more to them than anything else they could be doing. So,
you know, that's great. Now, something we'll talk about at a later time, because you are Painless Wayne, and that is, comes from the tattoo part of your world, with Painless Wayne's tattoos. So we'll be back, and we'll do something on the ink world, but we're not going to mix that up because this guitar stuff is far, far too important. Now, remember, the party date is March
23rd.
And we are at
the Dive Bar on Maryland Parkway and Flamingo.
So don't forget, hit that thing up. What time are doors for this?
9 p.m.
And since we're in Vegas, pretty
nine,
much.
9 p.m. till 9 a.m.
That's it. We're going to roll you out of there. Remember, you could drink, but we ain't going to let you drive. So
yep, drop your keys at the door and your underwear soon after. So
enjoy that. Wayne, it was more than a pleasure to be here. The guitar shop is amazing. We can't wait to see some stuff. In fact, we'll be talking later because I think, you know, there's something I need. I've always had an idea or two that now might be the time
Sounds
to
good
get
to me.
Done. I appreciate everything. B-Rad, Buzz TV, Painless Wayne from Painless Guitars. We'll see you guys the 23rd. See ya.